I'm Amy Lash, and I'm here inside the Hub Culture studio. I love saying the studio.
What do you think about the studio?
It's fantastic. It's about time. This is your year. And I see some amazing presses and doubles between these and the other areas.
It's great.
It's beautiful.
Good.
You definitely have captured, you know, the essence of what it's being Dallas.
Georgie Benedette, thank you so much for coming along. Now, you run something very exciting called Align 17, which I've been very privileged to see the genesis from last year
yes.
to this year. Now, tell me, first of all, it's about getting private wealth yes. to invest through the Sustainable Development Goals in order to invest in the world we want to create by 2030.
Exactly. So to your point, we started last year. UBS, in their white paper, Mobilizing Private Wealth into Social Good, did a call to action to their private wealth investors to look more into what would it mean to transport more of their capital into impact investing, again, with the framework of the SDGs. Mm-hmm. So just to have an idea, the top 10 private wealth banks in the world have around $8 trillion of asset under management, and UBS is number one. So for UBS, as a Swiss bank, to make that commitment was a very powerful way to bring a lot of partners to the table in support of the idea of Align 17, which precisely is a way to take away all the friction along the path of investment to make sure that we have more of that private capital coming to support the SDGs.
So there were a few hurdles that you had to get through. What were those hurdles?
So even though around 30% of private wealth investors really are interested in coming into impact, above the 32% who already are, they had three different friction points. One was access to deal flow. So if you're not an impact investor, how do you even begin to understand where to invest? The second is the lack of bandwidth to analyze and do diligence impact deals. So investors know how to do, plain vanilla investments. Impact brings another layer of complexity. And the third one is the type of deals that were available to investors are usually packaged for institutional and sovereign wealth funds, but not for the private wealth client. So what we did in Align 17, we were one by one of those hurdles, and we made sure that we had an answer for private investors to be, make it ridiculously easy for them to then say yes.
So sometimes when we're faced in life with a lot of hurdles, it's easier to just turn away and say, no, we're just going to go the easy route. Mm-hmm. But who was pushing? Who's pushing yes. behind this move towards using the SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals?
I think what's interesting, if you look at the recent announcement by BlackRock CEO Larry Fink saying this is it, like we're not investing into businesses that are not addressing social issues, the tide has completely turned. Mm-hmm. I would say there's two dynamics at play here. One is the next generation millennials. So we are witnessing one of the largest transition of capital in history, and they have explicitly said they would not invest in things that don't have that impact component. And there's a subsector which is very important and that is happening now is women. Mm-hmm. So around 88% of women polled in the US, ultra high net worth, they're very much interested in aligning their values with their investments beyond philanthropy. Mm-hmm. So the conversation has shifted from saying, we don't need returns, this feels good, and let's put some capital here, to saying, no, impact investing is financially profitable. It also has the social environmental components, and women are ready to invest. So between the women and the millennials and the large corporations coming to the table, the tide is very clear. So that's where Align 17 from a timing perspective is for the right moment in time.
I was speaking to Anne Finucane, who's the vice chairman of Bank of America, about why they decided to do it. And she said, the head of our company was very behind moving towards, but it had to be done with profit alongside.
Right.
And so when they started to invest in, they started off with sort of an ESG focus, and right. environment was the first of the things that they looked at. And then came Trump's move to pull out of COP21. Mm-hmm. And her answer to that was, well, that was the U.S. government. Yeah. You can't, as a business, you don't make a decision one year and then the next year decide, no. Mm-hmm. Especially when you're at the beginning of the process and you're starting to sort of bear the fruits of your labor.
Exactly.
How important do you think businesses are going to be in driving this agenda towards 2030? Yes.
So I think our example is a great example of, I think to your point, that businesses know that it's just that you just described is noise, that the guidelines are there with 2030 goal for the global goals, and we know that there's a lot of opportunities that these has driven. So you know that, for example, there's around 5 to 7 trillion in investment opportunities associated with the global goals. So it's not a surprise that for Alliance 17 to come alive, we had the support of some of the biggest names in the world. So starting from UBS, PwC doing the impact assessment, Hamilton Lane, which is one of the largest asset managers in the world, Linklater, one of the top legal firms. All the corporates, they know that this is happening, this is a trend, and they want to be part of it. Mm-hmm. So I think 2030 global goals is the blueprint. And now the question is, each business has to find where do they fit and just do it.
Georgie, thank you very much for stopping by.
Thank you. It's nice to see you.
As always, I love you.
Yes.
I'm Amy Lush, and this is the Hub Culture Davos Studio.
Thank you.